Καλησπέρα σας. Good evening. Dear ladies and gentlemen, welcome to tonight's lecture. The director of the Archaeological Research Unit, Professor Lina Kassianidou, regrets that she cannot be here with us this evening due to another obligation. So it falls to me to welcome you and present to you tonight's speaker, Dr. Yulia Bozykina, who has come to Nicosia from Moscow to speak to us about a little known aspect of the relations between Cyprus and Russia from the 12th century down to the 17th. I had the pleasure of meeting Dr. Bozykina for the first time last summer at the International Congress in Belgrade, where we discovered that we share an interest in architectural representations in Byzantine and post-Byzantine art and their function therein. So, Dr. Bozykina was born in Moscow. She studied art history at the Moscow State University, from where she also obtained her PhD in 2010. The title of her doctoral thesis is The Image of the Sacred City in Late Medieval Russian Art. Since 2011, she's employed as a researcher at the famous Moscow Kremlin Museums, and currently she is working on the monumental task of the preparation and publication of a thorough study of the mostly 17th century wall paintings of the renowned Cathedral of Archangel Michael at the Moscow Kremlin. And that's where Ivan the Terrible is buried, no?
Yes.
Yes. Exactly. Okay. So it's a very important, extremely important monument. At the same time, though, she is also pursuing her own research, as evidenced by the recent publication of a study on the image of the monastery in Russian art from the 14th to the 16th centuries, where she explores the central role of monasteries in medieval Russian spirituality and culture, as reflected through images of monastic complexes and monastic life in Russian monumental and icon painting. And I also want to thank her very much, because she has presented this lovely catalog of an exhibition at the Kremlin Museums on Saint Louis, the French king, who also came to Cyprus, and the relics of the Saint Chapelle. And we thank her very much for this very thoughtful gift. So, without further ado, I invite Dr. Bozykina to the podium to unfold for us the story of images of Cyprus in medieval Russia.
Dear guests, dear everybody, I am very glad to be here tonight, and I would like to begin with words of acknowledgement and thanks to Archaeology Unit of Cyprus University and personally to Dr. Maria Parani, Professor of Byzantine Archaeology and Art History, who has invited me here. It would be not an exaggeration to tell that the island of Cyprus has been known in medieval Russia from it had been baptized, just because it is mentioned in the Acts of Apostles, for many times in connection with Apostles Barnabas and Paul, who visited Cyprus two times in his wanderings. Here he baptized Heraclius, son of pagan priest, on the way to Paphos, and damned a Jewish magician Bar-Jeshua, or Elim, in Paphos. Besides that, Cyprus is described as a real place in travel notes of pilgrims to the Holy Land, in chronicles and in diplomatic documents. Most evidences refer to 17th century. For Russia, it is late Middle Ages. One of these writings is called Story About Island of Cyprus. If we bring these evidences together, we could compose a picture of what did the medieval Russians think about Cyprus and its people, what things they noticed and fixed as important ones. The earliest description dates from 12th century, and the role of the latest pilgrim notes will play wanderings of Vasily Grigorievich Barsky, who visited Cyprus in 1726, 1727, and 1734-36. Despite the Age of Enlightenment, 18th century, his writings belong, however, more to medieval genre of pilgrimage descriptions. Even his language looks medieval. It includes descriptions or even pictures of churches, monasteries, and even Christian relics. For example, this. Different sanctuaries are the main goal of Vasily Barsky. At the same time, it was him who mentioned some special things about Cyprus, which are still actual. It is funny, but moreover, we still read about them in tourists' guides. I will tell about them a little later. Besides written sources, we are going to focus on some subjects of icon painting. First of all, there are great Christian saints tied with Cyprus, Saint Lazarus and Saint Epiphanius of Cyprus. In the later times, in 17th century, we can see even depictions of Saint Mamas in icons and mural paintings. Secondly, there are some icons of Mother of God, among them replicas of Kikotissa, and some different images with title of Cyprus, Kyperskaya in Russian language, truly or legendary, tied with wonder-working icons of the island. Their appearing in Russia may be tied with visits to Cyprus hierarchs, which came to Moscow. It happened many times in 17th century. We begin with written sources. As I have already told, in the written sources are, first of all, pilgrim notes, then chronicles, and then literary compositions. Two of literary compositions are actually about Cyprus, and one more is about something else, but it contains an episode where the ruler of Cyprus makes a fool of Turkish Sultan. How has he done it, I will tell you a little later. In the literature, the literature is more indicative, even more than pilgrim notes, because the author of literature composition has more possibilities to show his sympathies and view of the subject, making his own version of history. There are also documents describing visits of Cypriots to Moscow, to Tsars and Patriarchs. Well, we begin with pilgrim notes. The earliest text about Cyprus in Russian language dates to early 12th century and belongs to Abbot Daniel, who visited the Holy Land in 1104-1106. His description of Cyprus is rather short, but it is the very first one. He made his pilgrimage in 12th century, but the oldest manuscripts date to late 15th century. Here it is. Abbot Daniel writes the following. His note consists of three parts. First one is called About Island of Cyprus. He writes, Cyprus is a large island. There are many people there. It is rich in everything. There are 20 bishops, one metropolia, and plenty of holy relics of saints which rest on the island. Among them are relics of Saint Epiphanius, Apostle Barnabas, Saint Zenon, Bishop Trifolius, whom Apostle Paul had baptized by himself. The second chapter is about mountain where the Empress Helena established the cross. On the island of Crete, yes, the Russians mixed Crete and Cyprus, two islands from the very beginning, and in the copies of Abbot Daniel it happens as well. But be sure he means Cyprus. On the island there is a mountain where Empress Helena has set a Cyprus cross in order to drive out the demons and all the maladies from here.
She inserted into this cross one nail of our Lord's crucifixion, and until now, miracles and signs happen here. This cross is standing on the air. It is not fixed on the earth, held by the Holy Spirit only. And me, unworthy, adored this sanctuary, and I have seen it with my own wicked eyes, and wandered the island happily. His note contains one more chapter. It is rather ridiculous, but interesting. He says the following. It's called about the incense. He writes, here olibanum tree grows, and incense is being produced. They take it from the trees. There are many small trees in the mountains, not so tall as grass. And from these trees, the good olibanum drops, and they gather it in July and August. In other months, it doesn't appear. From Cyprus to Jaffa, there are 400 miles sailing the sea. Jaffa is town on the seashore not far from Jerusalem, 30 miles walking. So then he is going to Jerusalem. In 13th century, due to Tatar occupation of Rus and troubles with knights on the west, the pilgrimages to the Holy Land took place very seldom. The next pilgrim's evidence about visiting Cyprus is a pilgrimage of Agrifenius, Archimandrite of Our Lady Monastery, written about 1370. He has a very strange name. Maybe it is a squattered form of Agrippius or something else, and maybe he comes from Kiev. It is very strange writing. However, he writes only a few words about Cyprus and finds place to tell a few words about the cross. However, he says that the cross is of the good thief, but not the true cross. And this version we will meet several times. Zosimus the monk, 15th century. In the early 15th century, time of Renaissance in Italy, and Andrei Rublev icons in Russia, monk Zosimus from the Holy Trinity Lavra of St. Sergius, where Andrei Rublev iconostasis still stands, went to Palestine to make a proskynesis to the Holy Sepulchre. He chose way to Jerusalem through Cyprus, and saw it under the rule of Lusignans. Zosimus came to Cyprus from Jaffa to Larnaca. Let it be this picture. Visited the Holy Cross Monastery and Kikos, and he spent 3 months on the island, mainly in the city of Lefkosia. He notes new realities of political and spiritual life of Cyprus. The capital is a great city of Lefkosia, and here the Rex from Franks sits. He uses very strange words in Russian as Rigofriashski, so Rex, something like Roman word Rex, of Franks. Here sits the Rex from Franks, in other words, a duke, and possesses all the island, as well as his brother, who is archbishop. Zosimus says that there are only 4 Greek Orthodox bishops on the island, 2 of them are monks, and 2 of them men of world. Compare it with 20 who mentioned by Daniel. Now only 4. In Greek churches, in some manuscripts, in Latin churches, continues Zosimus, they sing using organs. He notes this because the Russians didn't use any musical instruments in the churches and still don't. So it is something unusual. And maybe it was even in Greek churches. His note reflects realities of that time, Latinization of Cyprus after 1196 and carrying the archbishop's cathedra from Famagusta to Lefkosia 1215, if I don't mistake. Finishing, Zosimus lists the cities of Cyprus with rather strange pronunciation. First, Lefkosia, Kyrenia, Siriuri, he means Famagusta. I don't know why, but Limassos, he names this city Lemosh, Starosika, Limassos, Lemosh, Epaphos, Epaphos, Kitea, Larnaca. He says that Lefkosia is the first city, the second one is Kyrenia, and there, not far from it, there is a village of Morpho, belonging to the ruler, not far from it. He says that the word Morpho translates into Russian as very good. It's not true, Morpho could be translated into Russian as very beautiful. However, he mentioned it, and he says about St. Mama's relics and mirror emanating from his sarcophag on the Saint's Memory Day. Speaking about Larnaca, he reminds St. Lazarus. Among the sanctuaries and relics of Cyprus, he mentions Empress Helena's cross. He repeats the evidence of Daniel that the cross is standing on the air, although attributes it to the righteous thief as Agrifenius. In the late 15th century, about 1456, another pilgrim, Varsanophios from Novgorod, has also visited Cyprus. on his way to the Holy Land. He writes very shortly about the island. However, he says that he has visited the mountain where the St. Helena has established the Righteous Fifth Cross and Monastery of St. Mamas in the place he calls Stomorpho. Maybe it is Greek. Stomorpho. For him, it was turned into the name of the place, Stomorpho, where his relics are secreted in Miron. In the late 16th century, the Russian merchant and diplomat Trifon Korobeynikov went to Constantinople and Holy Land with a mission to establish contact with Eastern churches, because Russia has got patriarchate not long ago from that date in 1589, and we've got to make some new relations with the Eastern patriarchates. Journey of Trifon Korobeynikov began in 1593, and in 1594 he brought a model of Holy Sepulchre to Moscow. His notes were one of the most popular reading in the 17th and even 18th century Russia. Maybe some abstracts of his notes are retelling of other pilgrims' evidences. Anyway, his description of Cyprus is rather short and includes almost the same things as Obed Daniel's, including note about incense as well, but they look more fantastic or more medieval if you want. Trifon writes the following about Cyprus, the great island. The island of Cyprus is very large and rich in everything, and many people live here, and the olive trees grow here, and they make here oil, and the Greek soap is produced here. Here rest many relics of saints, many big ships board here, and there is a high mountain where Empress Helena has set a cross and inserted in it nails of our Lord's Passion. Daniel was speaking about only one nail. Trifon Korobeynikov says already about nails, more than one. So Helena has established the cross in order to dry everything bad from the island, and miracles and healings happen all the time here. They say, he continues about incense, they say that on an island of Cyprus, frank incense comes up. It falls from the sky like dew, 2 months a year in July and August, sometimes it doesn't at all. And the pious people take it and sell to merchants by the weight, and use by themselves, of course. In the 17th century, we have mainly documents about Cypriots visiting Russia. And in the first half of 18th century, we have few pilgrimages, very traditional in form and content. In this time, Russia and other European countries have built regular and constructive relations with Turkey, which gave possibility for the Christians to make pilgrimages to Holy Land. At this time appear a few of pilgrimage notes, and one, and among them, as I promised, is notes of Vasily Grigorievich Barsky. As I promised, he will be the last medieval Russian pilgrim. We take him because of genre of his notes and even essence of his journey were totally medieval. He went to see sanctuaries. It is something medieval, because, for example, Théophile Gautier or other travelers of new time got another goals. Coming from contemporary White Russia and Ukraine, his parents were from White Russia, he was born in Kyiv, Barsky belongs to Russian Orthodox culture as well, in wide meaning of this word, because he even tells about himself and his language as Russian. That's why I include him also in my speech. So, Vasily Grigorievich Barsky. He calls himself Barsky. He calls himself Barsky because his father came from the town Bar, contemporary in White Russia. Sometimes he says that his surname is Plaka or Albov. This is translation into Greek and Latin languages of still widespread Russian surname Belyaev. Belyaev Albus, something about white. He visited Cyprus in 1726, 1727, and in 1734-36, not taking into account short visits of ships he sailed into Cyprus harbors, on the way somewhere else. He writes much about Cyprus, he draws its cities and monasteries, not all of them, but the most beautiful ones, possible to be drawn with effect views. Leaving Cyprus in 1727, Vasily Barsky makes kind of summary like previous pilgrims, kind of summary about the island in the whole kind of panegyric. First of all, let us make with him a whole picture of Cyprus, seen with the eyes of 18th century traveler. Then we revise some interesting and ridiculous facts he mentions and his predecessors did not mention at all. However, some of these things still look very actual. Moreover, we read about almost all of them in traveler's guides. But the first person who wrote about them in Russian language was this Vasily Barsky. So I am citing. There are more than 70 monasteries on Cyprus, big and small. 24 of them, the most beautiful ones, I have drawn on a paper. Others, not so picturesque, I only describe. See about them on the leaves on my notes. Hereby I speak shortly words of praise about island of Cyprus, because many great things are situated there. Cyprus has very rich soils, so here grows so much corn and other grains that it is enough not only for plenty on an island, but for another land to sell as well. There is much anointing oil, honey, oil and cheese here, yes, he listed in such a question, in such a sequence, and many different animals. And best of them, our traveler liked the mules. Sometimes, when he is writing about them, he uses an ancient Greek word meski. Barsky says that they are very good in appearance and in traveling qualities. Cyprus land is good for mining gold, silver, copper, iron, and other metals. Cyprus depths contain diamonds in the mountains next to Paphos and minerals for pigments for making paints for artists, which are taken in dry, waterless mountains. These mineral pigments are sold to Venetians, English, and French merchants for good money. There is also a stone. He names it Камень Бавалнянный. I don't know what is it. Or a paper stone. Barsky says these stones are mentioned in Dioscorid. I cannot show it, but because I don't simply know what is it. They are black stones with white or light green stripes. These stripes are structured like fibers. That's why he describes something like fiberglass and retells here a legend that Byzantine emperors used it to wear clothes made from that fibers. So there are stones and partly they have some other stuff inside and it looks like fibers, like, I don't know, like cotton. Maybe. Maybe. And he retells a legend that Byzantine emperors used it to make clothes from this stone, and in order to clean it, they used fire, not water. Asbestos. Well, here grow a big variety of trees, wild and fruit ones, many vegetables and watermelons and other eatable herbs, grapes and wines. Vast majority, but the best wine of them is one named Commandaria, sweet and fragrant. This wine they sell to Venetians and to other Western countries. Cyprus produces silk and ridiculous stuff alizarin with red root. The merchants make big money selling it. Then he is speaking about the people. Almost everybody here is intelligent and silver-tongued. The women wear fine-looking and very conservative clothes. Not 18th century, but however, we see some people on these pictures. There are many churches and monasteries and priests. Everybody keeps fasts and they sing in the churches beautifully and people are very pious. There are no robbers in the mountains, on the roads and on the crossroads. And there are very few thieves in the cities, just very few. And some magicians and swindlers. Barsky uses another word, something like adulterer, but taking into account this context, we think that he means really swindlers. He couldn't experience the first meaning of this word. So the magicians and swindlers are both Greeks and Turks, and there are few of them, not very many. So there is no crime on an island. Cyprus has four harbors where the ships from different countries come. There are great and famous countries around Cyprus from east and north: Anatolia, Arabia, Kilikia, Cappadocia, Pisidia, and other countries down to Constantinople. On the south are Jerusalem, Egypt, Libya, Ethiopia. On the west is Rhodes and other White Sea islands. Like all the medieval travelers and wanderers, Barsky names this sea, which is around the Cyprus, White Sea, although today White Sea is that situated on the Russian north, on the polar circle, actually. So he uses even very old names for geographical points, for seas, for countries. Finishing, he writes that he saw very wise and modest kind people and enjoyed their hospitality, wandering the island this way and that. Cyprus is a place deserving many prizes, Barsky writes, except one thing. The air is not very healthy in Levkosia and Larnaca. That's why he almost had not seen old people there. Maybe it is his idea, he haven't seen anybody old, so he thinks that the air is bad and the people simply cannot live long enough. Like this. Now let us talk about some details which he mentions and other pilgrims didn't. Many things he is writing about are something we still read in traveler guides and construct on this base our own picture of Cyprus. For example, Barsky was the first who made top list of places to visit. Very short, but nevertheless. On the top of this rating is St. Mama's Monastery. Kikos takes the second one. Third place, share different objects. He always compares them with St. Mama's Monastery and Kikos. I retell shortly how he describes them. St. Mama's Monastery stands on a very plain and beautiful place. On the east side, close to the mountains, in 1 mile to the west, there is a seashore. It looks like a town with four walls, not very tall, but rather wide and long. It has two big entrances, like city gates, large enough for the biggest chariot to enter it. All the monastery buildings are constructed from big carved pieces of beautiful white stone, like St. Sophia Cathedral in Levkosia. St. Mama's Church is the most beautiful one possessed by Christians on the island. It is rather big and it is rather wide and long, sustained with 10 pillars. It has 3 altars, but only the central one is in use now. The floor is covered with stone planks. The building has 12 or more windows. On the top, there is a dome with 8 windows. The church is excellent in everything. On the right side, in reality on the left, stands an icon of St. Martyr Mamas and marble sarcophagus. Some people are sure that his relics are inside. Others tell that they are not. As we all know, the French knights, crusaders, have taken some of the relics already in 13th century. Well, nevertheless, he writes, Miron appears miraculously from his tomb, and the pious people take healings from smearing themselves with it. Barsky adds that the Turks wanted to get such a wonderful monastery in order to use it themselves and to turn the church into a mosque. But the abbot himself found money for mosque to build it anywhere else and save it this way the monastery. So the abbot of the monastery gathered money to construct the mosque in order to save St. Mama's. Kikos. The monastery of Kikos in this rating takes the second place, and here Barsky pays much attention to the wonder-working icon of Kikotissa. Actually, the monastery takes the second place because it was more difficult to draw it for Barsky, because it has very difficult position in the mountains. So it was because of his laziness, maybe. Maybe not. He's talking about the icon of Kikotissa rather much, and he's talking about it not only like medieval pious traveler, but as rather contemporary person as well. He's talking about its possible relation to Apostle Luke. His argument is that the icon is painted in encaustica technique with wax and mastica, which is very ancient and nobody works like this nowadays, and already had not worked in Byzantine times. Of course, he couldn't see the icon. The people in the monastery told it to him. Barsky tells also that nobody can see the icon. At the same time, he knows that the icon gets new cover every 5 years. And when the monks pray the Lord for rain on the mountain, they open the Virgin's face on the icon. So there are some moments where the icon theoretically is visible. Besides the Christian sanctuaries, Barsky, as contemporary traveler, pays attention to the monuments of classical antiquity as well. He inspects and describes Aphrodite's sanctuary in Paleopaphos, and he says the following. In the very ancient times, the Greeks constructed here large and famous and precious temple in honor of dishonorable, nasty pagan goddess Aphrodite. Now it is ruined. The columns and pillars of his temple are so large and strong that three of them stand still instead of all of the earthquakes, disaster which happen on Cyprus very often. Many such columns lie on the earth, here and there, making the spectator to think about passing time and beauty. Barsky adds, for those who doesn't know, that Aphrodite has another name, Kypris, and that the Cyprus people in the ancient times, of course, venerated her very much in the deals of physical love. Describing numerous churches and monasteries, Barsky mentions their ceiling constructions, including famous timber roofs covered with clay tiles and rhodes. For example, about St. Elijah the Prophet Church, not far from Larnaca, he says that it has vaults, and these humpback vaults are visible from the outside. I show another example, Panagia Chrysalevus, but nevertheless, he mentions that some churches have visible vaults, the others don't. For example, in the St. John Lampadist monastery, the church has a dome, writes Barsky, but it is visible from inside only, from outside invisible, because all the church is covered with timber roof and clay tiles due to hard snows and frost. He was not the first Russian in the mountains of Troodos who saw such timber roofs, but he was very first to mention and to describe this thing and to even to give an explanation of it. He is talking about frost and snow. Among other Cyprus brands, he mentions carob tree and commandaria vine. About carob tree and carobs, she writes that the carobs grow here in such a plenty that Cypriots gather them with shovels like straw. And yes, they sell these carobs to the foreign merchants for good money. Commandaria for Barsky is something special, so he describes this wine walking through Kelani, where it was produced. This wine is sweet, fragrant, and strong, he says, and it doesn't spoil during the time, otherwise it gets only better. They make much of it and sell to Western countries. Then he mentions also salt lakes on Cyprus and says that they take salt from there, but this business belongs to Turks. Rivers. The rivers on the island are small, and not all of them exist all the year. This is strange for people from Eastern Europe with its large rivers. That's why Barsky fixes on it. He says that rivers on Cyprus are like brooks for Russians. However, the water here in brooks and springs is usually very good. The rivers of Cyprus, he continues, can disappear in the stones before they reach the sea. In some monasteries, he mentions even artificial ponds for saving water and for raising fishes. If I don't mistake, nowadays on Cyprus, the trout is still being raised like this. People and their special relations with time and space. We can read about it from books of Lawrence Darrell or somebody else, but Barsky writes about it a little another way. First of all, he says that Cypriots are very intelligent, naturally, from the birth. They are all silver-tongued speakers and learn very easily, especially the foreign languages. He could notice it while he was teaching Latin language students in Lefkosia by request of Archbishop, so he had some experience as a teacher of Latin language. Unusual thing Barsky says about Cypriots is that they measure distances not with miles or meters, I don't know, but with time. For example, this way, 1 hour walking. Or, for example, half an hour on a mule. So they use time and not space for measuring space. And to finish, I was For me, it was rather ridiculous and interesting that I wrote that I have read in Barsky's notes things I've read in Thomas Cook Guide for Cyprus, that it is absolutely safe, that there are no robbers on roads and crossroads in mountains as well. In the city maybe, but very seldom. So it is. I think we have finished it with Pilgrim's notes, and it's time to tell a few words about chronicles. There are very few. So in Russian chronicles, Cyprus is mentioned in connection with the war of 1366 and 1561, in connection with signing the chart of enthronement as Tsar of Ivan IV the Terrible, then not yet so terrible. Among the Eastern Christian hierarchs, signed the chart was Archbishop of Cyprus Damaskenos. Chronograph of Ierapheus, Metropolitan of Monemvasia, was known in 17th century Russia as well. It was translated from Greek into Russian in 1665-1666 on special personal request of Tsar Alexei Mikhailovich. He wanted to print it in Russian, but it didn't happen. As you know, it contains description of siege of Cyprus by Turks in 1570-1571. True names and dates are mentioned there. The author sympathizes all the Christians of the island, not only the Greeks, but Latins as well. This text contains horrible story of Venetian ruler of Amohostos, whose skin was grazed by Lalo Mustafa Pasha. This episode we will find in literature, but the victim will be Turkish commander. So we finish it with chronicles, not very much. Now it's turn of literature. As I have already told, literature is very indicative if we want to find out how somebody treat anything, somebody's attitude to anything. Because making a literature composition, you have right to do with your heroes anything. Story about coming of the Turk and Saracens to the island of Cyprus dates to the first half of 17th century. Its plot is founded on some realities, but the result is totally fantastic. It is the following. The Turks, in communion with the Arabs, Saracens, attack Cyprus in the year of 552, in other words, 70 years before Hijra and even before Prophet Muhammad was born. The island survives, and the enemies, both Arabs and Turks, with hundreds of thousands of troops, are trampled down, thanks to God and his miracles. The notable thing here is the image of Cyprus, the island of Christianity surrounded by a sea of enemies and permanently attacked, always standing against aggression and finally winning thanks to God and faith only, because otherwise it was simply impossible. Another fantastic episode tied with Cyprus is placed in the story about two diplomatic missions. This story, 17th century as well, is actually about Russian mission to Roman emperor of German nation called Maximilian, who foretells fortune of Russia for nearest 10 years and helps his vassal, ruler of Cyprus, to make a fool from a Turkish sultan. Both of them are anonyms. The notable thing here is that the Russian Tsar and Roman Emperor of German nation are not in conflict, although the Russian Tsar is Orthodox and the Roman Emperor is Catholic. However, they cooperate against the Turkish Sultan. The King of Cyprus asks the Turkish Sultan to name him brother, and the second Tsar, along with him, with the same titles the Turkish Sultan has, and to send him a document with seals confirming that the King of Cyprus is ruler of Constantinople, Antiochia, India, and many other glorious lands. For such a kindness, King of Cyprus promises to present the island to Sultan. Having got such a letter, Turkish Sultan became very enthusiastic because he could get such a wonderful land without war. That's why he named the King of Cyprus brother and the second Tsar and sent him the confirmation document. After this, Turkish Sultan gets Cyprus, but not the island itself, but a very detailed map of Cyprus on 60 sheets of Alexandrian papers with all the cities, villages, churches, and monasteries, and proposal from his new brother to give him throne of Constantinople because he has already sat long enough on it and now it's his turn. the throne of King of Cyprus. Having understood that the Christians had possibly made him a fool, Sultan gathers troops to conquer Cyprus. But Roman Emperor sends 1,500 galleys to help the King of Cyprus, and the end of the story is happy. After this, the Sultan, he doesn't name in this story, had to go back and not to communicate neither with the Emperor nor with the King of Cyprus due to the great shame. This episode is a dream about consolidation of Christians against the Ottoman Empire. It was a real project of emperors and popes since the late 15th century, that all the Christians stand against the Turks, hopefully with powers of Russians and other East European rulers. In the 17th century it was still actual because nobody wanted to deal with Ottomans, who were still very strong by themselves. The first story is fully devoted to the island of Cyprus. It is called On the Island of Cyprus and the Foot of the Savior's Cross. This story includes three novellas. First one is about defense of Kyrenia Fortress in 1570, founded very possibly on real evidences of Cypriot who took part in it. Two other pieces of this story tell about monasteries and relics. First one of Assumption Monastery and miracle-working icon of the Virgin. The second one about the Holy Cross Monastery and its relic, Foot of the True Cross. On the island of Cyprus, there was from its beginning the city of Kyrenia. And from this island, Tsar Justinian took a girl, Theodora, and married her. This information, maybe not true, appears only in the 14th century Church history of Nicephorus Callistos, well known in Moscow. Eusebius of Caesarea, for example, who was contemporary of Justinian and Theodora, doesn't mention from where she came, and we don't know if she really came from Cyprus or didn't. Nevertheless, in the city of Kyrenia, he found a bride, and that's why he renamed the city of Kyrenia into Justinian. As far as I know, it is not true. The city of Kyrenia had never name of Justinian. The city stands next to the island on a stone and the sea around it, continues the author. This is reconstruction of the fortress in Lusignan times, and here we can see that there is some water between one of the parts of the fortress. In a distance in the sea, there are fences and stone towers. There are gates into the city between them and a large chain. I tried to show. So, this he means that it is an island, and here is chain between the towers. When the ships enter the city, they put the chain down into the sea. That's why it is impossible to capture the city. The Turks have captured many cities on the island, except this city of Justinian, under which they stayed 21 years, and could do nothing with it. That's why the Turks invented this honest way to get into the city. They release an arrow from a bow with a letter for citizens. The message was, "We don't want anything from you. Just let few of us enter the city to have a look on your churches, and we will go away." The citizens of Justinian of Kyrenia prepared people and alarm bells and wrote an answer for the Turks. "Now we have few of people in the city, as many were killed in fallouts. Others died from hunger in besieged city. If you want to see church's beauty, pledge us your word that you have a look and go back." And the Turkish commander pledged his word that he enters the city and goes back, and he entered the city. He did not enter the church of Mother of God Hodegitria, just look into it through the doors. He began boasting to his men, "So long we've been standing under these walls, spilling blood. Now we are inside so easily." The citizens have heard this and began to beat alarm bells. They killed all the Turks except the commander. They told to him that if he baptizes, he will live, but the Turk refused. They skinned him and stuffed it with straw and sent it as a gift to the Turkish Sultan, who didn't like this gift at all, of course. And he sent them a letter about stopping of trading relations, no merchants and goods from Cyprus anymore. Citizens from Kyrenia answered him with declaration of the same sanctions. Ridiculous things, they are in war, but they are still trading. and they create some sanctions against each other, even only after the Turkish commander turned it into the toy was gifted to the Sultan. Second story is about wonder-working icon of Mother of God. Next to the city, continues the author, there is a monastery of Assumption. In the church, there is an icon of Mother of God with a child enthroned. Child is in front of her breast, blessing with both hands. It is a work of Luke the Evangelist. If Archbishop and his people want to pray for rain or for fine weather or for releasing from foreigners, they go to the church to take the icon. Sometimes they see the icon standing on the air next to the door, and there are drops of sweat on the brow of Our Lady. This is a good sign. They take an icon to the cathedral church of the city of Kyrenia. Sometimes they see the icon in its case and cannot move it, and they see tears in Virgin's eyes. This is a sign of sorrow. Third story is about the relic of cross, mentioned already by the earliest pilgrims. There is a cross monastery on the island. There is a cross there, with foot of true cross inside. Its ends are decorated with silver by Justinian the Emperor. The Pope of Rome has sent some merchants to this monastery with rich presents and food and drinks to donate the church, to give presents to abbot, to monks and ordinary people, to wine and dine them, and at the same time to find out where is the relic and how to get it, to steal, to buy, to something else. And they stayed in the monastery long and noticed a small window in the church and decided to take the cross through it. So they got the abbot and monks and everybody drunk, and in the night they came and they have stolen the wood of cross through this window and sailed away. At this moment a great storm raised and all the merchants and their ship got immediately missing. And the great waves came to the island and then gone, having left hills of sand on the seashore. And nothing was known about this island about the cross for 40 years. After this, one old man heard a voice in a dream, which ordered him to take the foot of true cross, and he told an old man where to find it. The old man told about it to his priest, but he didn't believe. The same voice had a speech to the priest, and the priest in his turn told about it to the archbishop, who also didn't believe until he heard the voice by himself. After this, the relic was really found, absolutely safe, and Archbishop took it to the city, to the Cathedral Church of Mother of God, Hodegitria. But the next morning, the relic was found in monastery on its old place. It is notable that in this piece, Cathedral Church is situated in Kyrenia, but not in Lefkosia. Contemporary researcher Belobrova says that the author of oral evidence, which is in the background of this story, could come from Kyrenia, and he could remember glorious past of his city. That's why Cathedral Church is in Kyrenia. As we see, literature lets its authors to model reality as they want. This reality is a triumph of fairness and incarnation of authors' thoughts about politics and fairness. Everybody who hurts the island takes punishment from people and from God. Sometimes all the Christians are protagonists. In other cases, as we have seen with the merchants from the Pope, they don't. All the positive figures. The last group of written sources is diplomatic documents. Among the diplomatic documents, first one is notes of Ambassador Novosiltsev. This document describes the beginning of the war between Turkey and Venice for Cyprus in 1570s. His informer must have been a Turk, because the name of the island is written like Kibors in Turkish pronunciation, instead of usual Russian Kipr or Kypros in a Greek way. Cyprus has become an apple of discord between Turks and Venetians, because the Venetians from Cyprus did many inconveniences to the Turks. For example, they robbed Turkish ships on their way to Egypt or simply did not let them go. At the same time, the Turks could have a war in Crimea, because the Crimean Tsar made some problems to Russians and the Russians were ready to answer him. So, war for two fronts for the Turks. The Russians were also in similar situation. There was danger from Crimea instead of all the professions of friendship from Crimean king, who often broke them. On another hand, there was a war in Baltic region. That's why such information was very, very important. Another kind of documents are direct and indirect evidences about visits of Cypriots to Russia. The earliest ones date to 15th century, although they are very indirect, almost mute. There is one Russian copy of St. John Chrysostom's writings in public library of St. Petersburg. First half of the 15th century with a Russian note, the Russian manuscript and Russian note, which says, this book, writing of John Chrysostom, was scribed by Euphemius, abbot of the Cyprus island. The question is, what was he doing in 15th century in Russia? It was not so actual relations between us, and where did he know Russian language so good in order to scribe books? Anyway, in later times, there are more concrete testimonies about Cyprus visiting Russia. There are documents of Greek-Russian relations in ambassador's department. Some of them are published, others are still in archive. First one dates 1623. People from Cyprus followed to Moscow to visit Tsar and Patriarch, but we see there are traces not only in the capital. For example, Archbishop Parfenius sent long time in Kiev on the way to Moscow, communicating with Piotr Mogila, Metropolitan of Kiev. There is an evidence that Cypriots visited Yaroslavl, rich trading center on Volga River. There is a Greek document, now it is a Greek document, of 1623, written by Cyprus priest Nicephoros in the city of Yaroslavl. Cypriot Nicephoros lived in Andronikov Monastery by Moscow as well. Maybe it is the same person. There are also other examples, but the main goal was Moscow. Maybe some Russians were that time on Cyprus, because one of the charts the Cypriots brought with them, one of Archbishop Christodoulos of 1626, was written in Russian language. One of the Greek handwrites of 1628, coming from St. Sophia Cathedral in Novgorod, has a Greek inscription. Hand of Matthew, the priest and proto-notarius of St. Archbishop of Cyprus. Those who read this book pray the Lord for him. Finished on August 1st, 1628, from Nativity of Christ. Most of guests from Cyprus were clergy people, but not only. Among them, there are merchants. For example, Cyprus merchant Ivan Antonov. The medieval Russians like to translate names, so we can meet in the documents. Ivan Petrov, the Greek, it is okay. They just like to translate names. German names, Greek names, Italian names. Giovanni della Volpe in Italian is Ivan Lisitsyn Fryazin in Russian, so it's okay. All these people could tell something about island and life here. Their words were retold and even fixed in stories like those I have told now. Real facts and fantasy mixed ridiculously and created image of the island far away, totally fantastic and absolutely real at the same time. Between 1632 and 1652, there were 10 visits of Cypriots to Moscow. Most of the visits were requests for financial aid to pay debts. The notable thing is that these requests were satisfied, all of them without exceptions. Other guests from the Orthodox East could not be so lucky. Some of them got refuses. Well, who visited Moscow in 17th century? In 1627, which is year of beginning of official relation between Cyprus and Russian churches, two monks of St. Michael Monastery from Levkosia came to Moscow. I suspect that it is Arkhangelo Monastery, Metohovs Kikos, described by our old friend Barsky. The monks' names were German and Joseph. They got a letter from Christodoulos, Archbishop of Cyprus, and they asked for financial aid because they needed to pay debts. The problem was the following. After Jacob, the bishop of Thamasia, who lived there on retire, died, the Turks came to the monastery and took all the precious things and imprisoned all the monks. They wanted to turn the monastery into a mosque, but the Christians living around have collected money and took horrible credits to buy the monastery back. Now they needed to pay these debts in order to save themselves. In 1622, 28 came Archimandritus Sophronios, which with almost the same story from Annunciation Monastery on Cyprus. Maybe it was a program of Turkish government with the same scheme to extradite the monasteries. In 1629 came Archimandrit Simeon from Famagusta, from Monastery of Archangels Gabriel and Michael. Their story was the following. The Turks used to come to the monastery to have a rest, so to say, and one day they came, ate and drank much, and there was a conflict between them. One of them was killed in a fight. The local authorities blamed the monks, arrested them, and tortured. The locals bought the monks out, and now they are in terrible debts. They need to pay 130,000 rubles. Even for today is rather much. That times it was a horrible sum. This is a chart, this is document translated into Russian and even with converted money. In the May of 1628 of the same year came Joseph, Archimandrit of St. Nicholas Monastery. He brought relics of St. Apostles Luke and Barnabas. He also asked for aid and he got it. He also got immediately a standard gift for ambassadors. It was 40 sable skins, 20 rubles from Tsar Mikhail Fedorovich, 15 rubles for everybody who was with him, then 40 sable skins and 10 rubles for everybody from Patriarch Philaret. In 1632 came Archimandrit Nicephorus from Cyprus, from St. Mama's Monastery. He told about debts and severe troubles in convent. Their debt was 2,000 golden coins. As everybody coming to Tsar, he got two recommendation letters with him, one from Jerusalem Patriarch Theophanes, another one from Archbishop of Cyprus Christodoulos. Archbishop sent to Moscow relics of Saints Cosmas and Damian. In 1642, Archbishop Parfenios, in the document there is the word Archbishop, that's why I'm telling it. Archbishop Parfenios, he came from Cyprus, from the Monastery of Archangel. This is exactly Monastery Archangelu, described by Barsky as one with many water wells. Archbishop Parfenios brought relics of Epiphanius of Cyprus and the Apostle Lucas and two icons on the gold background for Tsarina Evdokia Lukyanovna and Tsarevich Alexis, future Tsar Alexei Mikhailovich. Let us fix this last gift, the icons, and have a look on the visual arts. Saints of Cyprus. As I have already told, the Saints of Cyprus were well known in Russia since the earliest times, since the period of Kiev Rus. For example, Epiphanius of Cyprus is depicted in the apse of St. Sophia Cathedral in Kiev. This mosaic dates 11th century. St. Epiphanius stands in the apse along with Gregorius the Theologian, Clement the Pope of Rome, St. Nicholas of Myra, St. Stephen Protomartyr, St. Basil the Great, St. Gregory of Neocaesarea, St. Gregory of Nyssa, St. John Chrysostomus, and Laurentius Archidiacon. Of course, we knew St. Lazarus. We can see him in the late 12th century wall paintings, unfortunately gone during the World War II, in the Church of Our Savior on Neredica, not far from Novgorod. His face has traces of death he experienced. St. Mamas. St. Mamas appeared on the pillar of Assumption Cathedral of Moscow Kremlin. In wall paintings of 1642-1643, the photo doesn't exist yet. That's why I show another monument, because many cathedrals in cities and in monasteries getting wall paintings after painting of Assumption Cathedral in Moscow Kremlin use it to repeat its program. That's why we can find St. Mamas, for example, in Holy Trinity Cathedral of Makariev Monastery on Volga River. I suspect that some relics of the saint were brought from Cyprus to Moscow. On one of reliquaries, saved in Annunciation Cathedral of Moscow Kremlin, there is an inscription that it contains relics of St. Mamas and it dates to 17th century. Unfortunately, it is not yet published. That's why, just believe me, that we have some that in Moscow Kremlin from 17th century there were relics of St. Mamas. Later, Apostle Barnabas. He is depicted on one of the arches in Archangel Michael Cathedral in Moscow. The wall painting dates 1666. The last our subject is Mother of God icons. In the 17th century, in Russia appear icons of the Virgin tied with Cyprus. For example, this one, painted by famous artist Simon Ushakov in 1668. It has some interesting feature. First of all, it is a mirror image. It happens in Cyprus art as well, as you know. Actually, Ushakov has painted at least two images of Kikotisi, and the second one you see now for Florishcheva Pustonj, this is a direct copy. The second interesting feature of the icon we are talking about is inscription in two languages, both Greek and Russian ones. Greek letters are very large, Russians are very, very small, like subtitles in cinema. On the background, in large golden letters, we read Iyeleusa I Kikotisa. Between the lines, in small letters, we see Russian translation, Milostivaya, something like Iyeleusa. The child has a roll in his hand. And we read also a Greek quotation from Isaiah on it. Pnevma Kirio ep eme u eniken ech pisen me. On the background next to the roll we see Slavonic translation of it. Duh Gospodin na mne, Evo zaradi pomaza mea. The Spirit of Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. Simon Ushakov, artist of Armory Chamber, who worked much in Kremlin, must have seen icons brought by Cypriots, which was mentioned above. Later Russian copies of Kikotisa icon, by the way, save these bilingual inscriptions. So it is it was important that it is copy of something Greek, that it is copy of something brought from there. Even the letters are foreign. The last our subject is Our Lady of Cyprus, in the Russian language, Kiprskaya. This is rather complicated subject, because in Russia in 17th-19th century there were known few different icons with title of Kiprskaya, of Cyprus. The memory days of it are on the day of Pentecost and on the Sunday of Orthodoxy, the first Sunday of the Great Lent. The legend in the background of those icons is the same, one about Arab who shot an arrow into image of the Virgin with a child, and the icon, in some versions mosaic, began bleeding. First of all, as we can judge on convolutes of images of Virgin icons, there were images of Mother of God with child sitting on the throne accompanied by angels with crown on her head. It is very difficult to tie such images with any specific Cyprus icon, but it is meant that these icons are replicas of some image painted by Luke the Evangelist and which is situated on Cyprus. Our old friend Vasily Barsky quotes this legend visiting Kitty, the Church of Panagia Angeloktisti, and admiring mosaic in its apse. This is really mosaic, there are angels accompanying Mary. Maybe the Russian images of Kiprskaya, like this, yeah, are really somehow through printed graphic or somehow else are tied with Kitty mosaic. But in all the inscriptions of icons Kiprskaya, the Virgin is sitting on the throne, although Kitty Virgin stands. And moreover, she doesn't have any crown on her head, because in the 6th century such crowns simply didn't exist. Sometimes the epithet Kiprskaya was applied to icons of Kikotisa. For example, the sample for Kikotisa in Siski pattern book for icon painters is named wonder-working icon Kiprskaya of Cyprus. Although on the background in the sample itself we can recognize Iyeleusa I Kikotisa. There is one more icon called Kiprskaya or even Kittyskaya, which means from Kitty. The legend says that it was situated in the Church of St. Lazarus, not in one of the Virgin, as previous one, And that it was wonder-working, and that copy of this icon was sent in very, very ancient time to Russia by Jerusalem Patriarch for Russian dukes as blessing. The icon stood in Assumption Cathedral of Moscow Kremlin by northeast pillar next to Tsarina's praying place. Not long ago, goes on the legend, the icon has been restored because it was very old. There is a picture of that, how it looked in 19th century. Here's the pillar, kiosk with icon, people praying. It has something in common with Kikotisa, but not the same. The icon wasn't identified in our museum collection by my colleague Tatiana Tolstaya. Its central part refers to 17th century. Left and right sides are latest reconstruction. In the cathedral inventories, it is mentioned like Kiperskaya of Cyprus. We don't know there wasn't such an icon of Moscow Kremlin in ancient times, or more probably this icon we see on the watercolor is a copy of one small icons brought by Cyprus hierarchs and their representatives in 17th century. Why do I tell that it is copy from those icons brought from Cyprus? Because it was rather uneasy to travel in 17th century and it was physically impossible to bring something large. But they could bring something small and then to make a copy. As we know from document, one of those icons was specially for Tsarina, for Evdokia Lukyanovna, for wife of Alexei Mikhailovich. And in the late 19th century, the icon was still standing next to the place where Tsarinas used to pray. So maybe there is something it is. Conclusion. Cyprus, seen with the eyes of medieval Russians, is something like treasure, the island of plenty Christian relics, if not the relic itself. Cyprus relics are ones of saints, wonder-working icons, and the first rank Christian sanctuary, the Holy Cross. The island is almost always in danger, but due to the heaven, it saves faith and people. In 16th century, the Russians were watching everything regarding the Ottoman Empire, so the Russian ambassadors, for example, Ivan Petrovich Novosiltsev, collected information about politics of Turks, their plans for wars, and Cyprus was one of such plans because of conflict with Venetians who possessed island and teased the Turks. In 17th century, Cyprus and Russia begin direct contacts. And that's why the island appears immediately in literature pieces founded on evidences of Cypriots themselves. Guests from the island bring to Moscow gifts, relics and copies of wonder-working icons. Among them, icons of Our Lady Kikotisa and some other images called in Russia Our Lady of Cyprus. The Russian painters make copies of them and underline connection of their works with prototype. That's why they keep the Greek inscriptions, giving Russian subtitles. Cyprus origin is very important as well, as more than image is called from Cyprus. So it is something like Jerusalem, like Holy Land for Russians. In the 18th century, thanks to Vasily Barsky, we have not only descriptions of island and its sanctuaries, not only political and geographical information, but something new as well. Pictures with Cyprus sites, information about goddess Aphrodite, commandaria wine and carob tree, as well as mules, and that the island is safe and free from criminality. He says many good words about Cyprus people, and this picture he has drawn is hopefully still actual and still is a background for our relations today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this very thorough survey of what the sources can tell us, what the Russian sources can tell us about Cyprus from the 12th to the 17th century. And I'm sure there's going to be plenty of questions. I have a few, but
okay.
Just
about Patriarch Ignatius, he was also Cypriot, Stelleritis wrote this in the...
Gennadius, you mean one... Ignatius. Ignatius wasn't Cypriot.
No, after death of Hermogen.
Yes, I know.
Pseudo-Demetrius.
Yes, yes.
And Stelleritis mentioned him as Cypriot.
Yes, there are some evidences that he named himself a Cypriot, but however, in later documents, he also mixed Cyprus and Creta, and maybe he had nothing to do with Cyprus. He could come from Greece, it is obvious, from some Greek world, but there is no, we cannot be sure that he was from Cyprus. Of course, of course, maybe he used it the, from where? He was in Rязань, but actually he was Greek. He came to Moscow from Rязань, where he was doing something before.
Is not included by this. He became from medieval more suspicious, more.
Yes, yes, more scientific.
Yes,
yes. Well, Barsky really. Got some episodes where he was very ill, and after this he was going better, but I think that his pious thoughts and his scientific thoughts are mixed in his head, in his souls, not because he was ill or healthy, just because he was such a person who was living on the border of two different worlds. Yes, and interesting thing is that he knew Latin language very good, but Greek language he didn't know it very good, and he actually went to Patmos to learn Greek language, and it was some troubles in the way, and he had to stay on Cyprus teaching Latin language. Because on Cyprus, it's ridiculous, but it is so, there were no teacher for Latin language good enough. And so the archbishop asked him to teach a little. Yes, for winter. Later, it happened a disaster. It was an earthquake, and later it began plague, epidemic. And that's why Barsky left Lefkosia and went wandering along the island.
The evolution of one person,
something like this. No, something like this, but he is sometimes he's pilgrim, sometimes he is traveler, so it is episodes. For example, Théophile Gautier is pure traveler, but we cannot say that Barsky is, has an evolution. But he is both things, and he is a pilgrim and he is at the same time traveler. Yes.
How is he represented in, I couldn't, it wasn't very clear the image, and I was,
yes, unfortunately.
How is he, what is the iconography of the saint?
You know, in about St. Mamas, the iconography had almost nothing to do with Cyprus. In the late 16th century, in our sample book of Sofia Cathedral in Novgorod, we have St. Mamas, and it is, and we read the following, that he looks like St. George with shepherd's crook. in the hand and nothing else. And the images of Saint Mamas I know in late medieval Russian paintings are, yes, the youth, maybe with shepherd's crook, maybe without, so without any special features like lion or lamb in his hands. You know, the only one thing, the only one evidence about relics of St. Mamas I know is a little case from Annunciation Cathedral in Moscow, from private Church of Russian Tsars, where it is written that there is some relics of St. Mamas. Other cases, I don't know. We don't know, because in the documents, I was reading to you documents, there was one person who came from Morfo, from St. Mamas Monastery, but it wasn't any word about the relics of St. Mamas, so we don't have any written evidences. I can suspect that the people came to Moscow Kremlin with gifts, with relics, with icons, and approximately at the same time, we have casket for relics with Mamas relics, only like this. It is indirect, but it is there is some logic in it, I think.
I was just wondering because there are other places where the cult of St. Mamas also existed. I mean, from France to Italy to
from
other places as well. So.
Interesting thing, interesting thought, but I don't know. Maybe I simply don't know the episodes when Catholics come to Russia with such gifts, but we must check it because we don't know, maybe it happened. Good idea, thank you. Yes, it was Barsky.
Okay, because I was thinking of in the area of Pyrgos where Stylianos Perdikis is excavating, he mentioned actually a kind of crystal. It's a type of crystal that comes out of the which is in the broader area of Paphos.
So it is true. Maybe.
And I thought that was very interesting to this kind of. Yeah, we should tell.
You mentioned in Lusignan.
Yes. So it goes back, but I mean, it is very interesting to think about that because maybe it continued so late to have this kind of. I mean,
do we know if Barsky was reading any of the
areas? Maybe he was reading, maybe he was always speaking with people. He knew Greek language rather good, so the Greek language he went to learn to Patmos was ancient Greek. He made a difference, but the new Greek he knew rather good, and I suspect that different things was not only his experience, but the people from Cyprus told it to him. Maybe about diamonds it was something like this.
It's interesting that, you know, because there is something that could have been, you know, maybe presented, you know, to make it more impressive, but it's
maybe.
Something was happening there.
Actually, Barsky gathered not diamonds, but that asbest stone, but on his way to Palestine, to Jerusalem from Jaffa, he was robbed by the Bedouins and nothing was brought to Kiev, including asbest.
I was rather intrigued by those stories, the literature, and I was wondering who was the audience for those stories? I mean, who was reading those novels or whatever you call them?
Aha. I can tell that, first of all, readers of such stories and their authors were people who were working in ambassador's department, посольский приказ, people who could read, people who knew many things, people who knew about island of Cyprus. So there were elite and people who could, people of rather high social rank. But you know, I think that it was not only them, because such stories in 17th century Russia were very popular, about the lands far away, about the sanctuaries, about some action. First of all, such pieces of literature, for example, one about Turkish Sultan, they were born as, you know, today, nowadays, in internet, we can find some stories which happened or didn't happen in some reportages, which happened in some countries, like, I don't know, Syria, Ukraine, where something terrible is happening, something political. It is like not only literature, but it is like publicistic, ideological something to read, and the people who read it made a special picture, which was idea of the author of text. So it was something like, first of all, literature, amusing literature, and second, ideology, something like we can read in newspapers and internet, for educated people, so to say. Yes.
100 years after Varsky, but they promote it with imperial script, with publishing this, with distributing this. Like
And before printing, especially pilgrimages, not even the literature, you were asking about the literature, if I understand good. Well, literature was for educated people, but pilgrimages, these descriptions, they were for everybody who could read. Because Russians, you know, Russia was has always been a little closed country, and the people like it very much to read about lands far away, really. Yes.
Questions?
One last observation. In the inscriptions on the icons, it's actually...
I can return it.
Yeah, it actually says Kikiotisa.
Kikiotisa, yes.
And I simply wanted to point out that if Sophocles was here, he was going to say that. But there is a 12th century icon, it's not that bad, but there are some actually Cypriot Byzantine icons where you actually have Kikiotisa.
Okay.
Kikiotisa.
Uh-huh.
If you want, I can, you know, find the...
I return it with pleasure.
Even this inscription, probably it comes from.
I found.
Because it's very clear. It's from Ypsilon Kikiotisa. So.
I'm sorry, Konstantinos. How to open the program? I've closed everything. I found the picture.
Yeliausi.
Yes.
Kikiotisa. Yes.
Yeah. You simply just have to put it on view. Yeah, there it is. So you see, it's very clear.
Kikiotisa, yes.
Even the inscription must come from an actual Cypriot model.
Wow.
So I'll find the reference, and I think I saw it in a catalog somewhere. I don't remember which one it is, but. You find find this inscription.
So well, I think so. Thanks a lot. You know, Simon Ushakov, this painter, was a very educated person. He knew Greek language, but sometimes he made some mistakes. Now I was looking at this inscription, and I found it rather strange. But sometimes he was right.
Mm-hmm. But it's she's actually sometimes called Kiki officer. So whatever he saw must have had this kind of he didn't make a mistake.
Good, wonderful, thank you.
The spelling is no worse than the secret, so it's fine. So if there are no other questions, thank you again. Thanks for this very
thank you to everybody for coming.